Hello friends, this video on NEET Ray Optics is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Question number 22. A ray of light is incident at an angle of incidence I on one face of a prism of angle A and emerges normally from the opposite face. If the refractive index of the prism is mu, the angle of incidence I is nearly equal to. Okay, so let's draw the diagram of a prism. So let's say this is the prism. And this is the angle of prism. Now let's say that this is a ray of light which is incident on this face of the prism. So if this is the normal, then this is the angle of incidence. Now as it enters the prism, the ray bends and this is the angle of refraction, right? And then it emerges out normally from the opposite face. So basically it emerges out like this, that is, this is normal. Okay, so in this case, what is happening? So what are the values that are given here? So basically this is normal, so that means angle of emergence is equal to zero because the emergent ray is coinciding with the normal, so angle of emergence is zero. R2, so this is normally our R1, so similarly we have another R this side, so that R2 is also equal to zero in this case. So therefore, in this case, we can say A, which is normally equal to R1 plus R2, this angle plus this angle is equal to A. So we have derived all of this relationship when we have discussed about refraction in prism. So here we can say A is equal to R1. Now let us apply Snell's law. So as per Snell's law of refraction, we can say that sine I by sine R1. So we are applying Snell's law at this surface. So this will be equal to refractive index of glass by refractive index of air, or we can say refractive index of glass is basically refractive index of prism. So let's mark it as mu p. So mu p will be equal to sine I divided by sine R1, and refractive index of air is equal to 1. Right? So from this we can say that sine I is equal to mu sine R1. So R1 is equal to A. So this can be written as mu sine A. Now we know that for small values of theta, sine theta is approximately equal to theta. So if theta is very small, in that case we can say that sine theta is approximately equal to theta. So we apply the same logic. So sine I can be written as I, sine A can be written as A. So therefore from this we can say mu is equal to, or we can say that I is equal to mu A. So the correct option is A. Question number 23. The magnifying power of a telescope is 9. When it is adjusted for parallel rays, the distance between the objective and eyepiece is 20 centimeters. The focal length of the lenses are. Now, the moment we talk about parallel rays, what does that mean? That means that the object is at infinity. So when the object is at infinity, then the rays that would come from there would be parallel rays, right? Now, what is the magnifying power of a telescope when the object is at infinity? So magnifying power is given as the ratio of the focal length of the objective to the focal length of the eyepiece. So that's a relationship which we already know. There is another relationship which we already know, and that is the tube length of the telescope is given by sum of the focal length of the objective and the focal length of the eyepiece. Now with the help of these two relations, we will be able to solve this question. So here the value of this magnifying power is given as 9. So basically F0 by FE is given as 9, or we can say F0 is equal to 9 FE. And what about the tube length? This tube length is given as 20 centimeters. So we can say 20 is equal to F0 plus FE. Now instead of F0, we can write 9 FE plus FE. Or we can say 10 FE is equal to 20, or FE is equal to 20 by 10, which is equal to 2 centimeters. So focal length of the eyepiece is 20 centimeter, and focal length of the objective would be 9 times FE, that is 9 into 2, which is 18 centimeters. So the focal length of the lenses would be 2 cm and 18 cm. That is C. Question number 24. A lens having focal length F and aperture of diameter D forms an image of intensity I. Aperture of diameter D by 2 in central region of lens is covered by a black paper. Focal length of the lens and intensity of the image now will be respectively. Okay, so now if you have a lens like this, one basic thing that you need to understand, if you have a lens like this, let's say that you make a small aperture here and then you cover it with a black paper. So even if you do this, the focal length remains unchanged. There is no impact on the focal length of the lens. However, there is an impact on the intensity, because intensity is all about how much light is passing through the lens. So the bigger the aperture, more light would pass, more would be the intensity. In this case, since you are covering the central region by a black paper, so less amount of light would enter. Therefore, the intensity would also reduce. So how much will it reduce? Let's see. So intensity is basically proportional to the area exposed to light. That means how much area is allowing light to enter. Right. Now, initially, before, covering it with black paper. So initially, let's say that the intensity was I1. So during that time, what was the area which was exposed to light? So that time the area was pi r square. So r is basically half of the diameter. So this would be this much was the area, which is pi d square by 4. Okay. Now what happened later? So once we covered it with the black paper, then what happened? Now my intensity is I2, and how much is the area now? So now the area is actually the earlier area, the initial area, minus that area of the central region. Now the central region is of diameter d by 2, right? So that means the area of the central region would be pi r square. So r would be d by 4. So pi into d by 4 square. Now a1 is pi d square by 4 minus pi d square by 16. So this is equal to 3 pi d square by 16. So this much is the area later. Now you can find out the ratio, that is I2 by I1 will be equal to A2 by A1, which will be equal to 3 pi d square by 16 divided by A1, which is pi d square by 4. So you can cancel these. So the ratio is 3 by 4. So you can say that I2 is equal to 3 by 4 I1. That means initially the intensity, as per question, the initial intensity was I. So later the intensity would be 3 by 4 I. So correct option is C. Question number 25. A microscope is focused on a mark on a piece of paper and then a slab of glass of thickness 3 cm and the refractive index 1.5 is placed over the mark. How should the microscope be moved to get the mark in focus again? Now, let us first try to understand the concept of the question. So, what is happening here? The moment a glass slab is introduced, what happens? The light undergoes refraction because of the introduction of the glass slab of thickness 3 cm. As a result, now the position of the mark which you will see is basically the apparent depth of the mark, that is not the real depth. So here we have to play around with the real depth and apparent depth of the mark. So first of all, you will have to understand that the real depth of the mark is 3 cm. So how do we say that? That's because let's say that if this is a sheet of paper and you have a mark here. Now you place a glass slab over it. So what is the depth of that mark? That depth is basically the width of the glass slab or the thickness of the glass slab, right? Because over that mark doesn't have any thickness of its own. And you have just placed a glass slab on top of it. So thickness of the glass slab is basically the real depth of the mark, right? Okay, so now the question But the problem is that when you see it through the glass slab, you do not see it at a depth of 3 cm. That's because when you are viewing it through the glass slab, the rays of light are actually undergoing refraction as they are passing through the glass slab because there is a change in medium. So you are not seeing it at 3 cm, you are seeing it somewhere else. And that somewhere else is the apparent depth. And we know that refractive index of a material is equal to real depth by apparent depth. So in this case, refractive index is 1.5, real depth is 3 cm, apparent depth we don't know. So apparent depth will be equal to 3 divided by 1.5. So this is equal to 2 cm. That means when we are seeing the same mark through this glass slab, so actually the mark is the real depth of the mark is 3 cm. But when we are seeing it through the glass slab, we see it as 2 cm. So basically it is somewhat like this. The mark actually is here, right? Let's say this is the thickness of the glass slab, right? And let's say that this distance is 3 cm. But when you are actually seeing from the top, so you are basically seeing it through the glass slab. So you are not seeing it here. You are seeing it somewhere here. So you are seeing the depth as 2 cm. So this depth is 2 cm only. So that is what is happening in this case. Now the question is, how should the microscope be moved to get the mark in focus again? So how should you change the position of the microscope? Now your mark has moved up. So earlier, if your microscope was here, so since your mark has moved up, your microscope also needs to move up. So therefore, the microscope has to be raised from its previous position. And by how much? It has to be raised by that much distance by which the mark has raised. So by how much distance the mark has raised? So this is the distance. So this much distance is 3 cm minus 2 cm, that is 1 cm. So basically by introducing the glass slab, the change in the depth is 1 cm. Therefore, the microscope needs to be moved upward by 1 cm. So that is option A. So please try to understand this picture. This will help you to understand this problem very nicely. So you found out apparent depth. So it basically means earlier. So let me draw a bigger version if you are not able to understand it. Let's say this is the glass slab and this is the mark, okay? So this is the real depth, which is 3 cm, right? But when you are seeing it like this through this glass slab, then what is happening? You are seeing the same mark at 2 cm depth. That means you are seeing it somewhere here. And this distance is 2 cm, right? So that means the mark raised, the mark moved upward by how much distance? By 1 cm. So therefore, the microscope also need to move up by 1 cm. Thank you. Please visit examfear.com for free quality education. You can learn with a simple 4-step learning process wherein you can watch video lessons, you can ask your questions, you can refer notes, and you can take a free online test. We have content for class 6 to 12 on physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology along with practical videos. So please subscribe to our channel for daily updates. Thank you.